Okay, well, I've got a list of questions.
Uh-huh.
There are a lot, but we may cover things in some of the questions, so I won't need to ask further questions.
Yeah.
It just depends. But well, we'll go from here. So, look, okay, the first thing we need to ask is, whereabouts were you born and where did you grow up?
I was born in Aspidelazouch, but I spent, from the age of about six in Stratford-on-Avon until I joined the Air Force, and I never went back to live there.
Right, okay.
I got married after I finished my operations, and after living with my wife's parents until we could find our own place, I didn't really go back to live in Stratford. My wife wanted to, but I didn't.
So we know who wore the trousers then.
Huh?
We know who wore the trousers.
Yes, indeed.
Can you remember the first time you saw an aircraft?
Yes, it would be in Stratford. We used to have these people coming around giving flights to people, you know. And there was a big field just over the river in Stratford, and they used to use that. And that's, I think, was where I first saw an aircraft.
Yeah, any idea what sort it was?
It was a biplane, but apart from that, I've no idea.
And what did you feel when you saw it? What were your impressions of it?
Oh, very interested, really. Of course, in those days, there weren't many cars around, let alone aeroplanes. And it was quite impressive, really, that they could get the darn thing off the ground and get it down again safely.
And did you have an opportunity to go in one of those or get near it?
Not really, no. No, and I couldn't go on it. I didn't have the money for a start because they were paying admission for it.
Okay. When you saw that aircraft, did it make you feel as though you wanted to fly? Was it something that made you look at it and think that it may be a career? Or was it just nice at the time, but then other things?
I don't think I got as far as wanting to make it a career. Yeah, that was a bit early. I was still only, about 9 or 10 sort of thing. It was a bit early for that. I was very interested, and that interest followed all the way through, really, whenever I saw anything about aircraft, particularly when the war started, that increased it. Mm.
Okay. Well, I'm going to move forward quite a chunk now. When obviously war broke out, how old were you?
39, I was 16.
Okay, so that was too young to enlist?
Oh, yes.
Do you remember your thoughts when you heard that war had broken out?
A bit of excitement in a way, I think. I don't think anyone expected it to develop as it did, and rather thought, as people were saying at the time, it would be all over by Christmas. But it never was, of course.
And with your family, were there any siblings who were old enough to join?
I had an older brother who was called up and into the army. He was unfortunate, I'm afraid, because there was a Polish doctor who was administering the various injections that everyone had, and unfortunately used a dirty needle, and he ended up with spinal meningitis. He did recover, but he spent a long time in hospital and was eventually discharged. But that was his unfortunate experience.
Okay. Well, when it came time for you to enlist, did you enlist or were you called up?
No. I was a bit sneaky, really, because I, without telling anyone, my family or anyone else, I got on a train, went into Birmingham and to the recruiting office and volunteered for aircrew. They accepted me there after one or two initial questions, a bit of a medical, and sent me off to Cardington, where I had a full medical and a lot more questions, and was accepted there for training as aircrew. That was in February 1941. I was 17 and a half, roughly.
Was that, I don't know the ages, was that still too young to enlist, though, officially?
No, I could have done, but they were recruiting a lot of people at the time because Bomber Command was expanding. And after being accepted, they then sent me home, told me to join the ATC, and they would get in touch. They did get in touch about 6 months later, and I went back to Cardington with more questions and so forth, and they changed my classification to pilot under training and sent me home again until February 42, when they eventually decided I should get into uniform.
Well, you said that you were sneaky and that you signed up effectively behind your parents' backs. How did they feel when they found out you'd enlisted?
Surprisingly, they weren't very upset. I don't really know whether they thought, oh, well, he'll manage on his own sort of thing, and perhaps they didn't realise what sort of dangerous occupation I was going to be involved in. But they weren't against it all, really.
When you enlisted, why did you choose aircrew?
I didn't like the idea of getting in trenches and walking about on the ground a lot, really.
Were the adverts, posters of the time, did air warfare seem more interesting then?
Yeah, I think so, yes. Of course, we'd had the Battle of Britain, but everyone aspired to be a fighter pilot, but there were only a select few who were. But I think the idea of flying generally was the attraction.
So, okay, I mean, that's one of the questions I was going to ask a bit further along. Mm. Everyone wanted to be a fighter pilot.
Oh, yes.
Was that your intention when you joined?
I think so, really, yes. But you went where you were told to go, and that was it.
So there was no choice of whether you went along to the air training school, and they just said, well, you're going to be training on bombers, you're going to be training on fighters. Is that how it worked?
No, I think up to a certain standard, the training was the same. And it was only when you got to the point of, I went to America for my basic training, and when we got back, it was a case of, do you go onto singles or onto multi-engined? And at the time, I suppose they'd got enough fighter pilots, and they were looking for a lot of bomber pilots. And so that was where I ended up.
Well, can I ask then, why did you go to America for your basic training?
Purely because I think there wasn't room here for it. And of course, the weather, the fact that there were operations going on here would interfere with the training. But over there, it wasn't just America, they went to Rhodesia as well. They actually went to America before America joined the war. They were there in civilian clothes. But we went over, they'd got these British flying training schools. Before they were established, they were actually being trained in American air bases, air training places. And they were also training in Canada. So the demand for bomber crews was quite enormous, really.
Okay. Can you tell me a bit about going to America? How did you get over there?
Well, after we'd finished 4 or 5 months in this country, we went first to Lord's Cricket Ground, of all places, where we all assembled. And after about 10 days in London, where we got kitted up, I went to an initial training wing. Mine was in Scarborough. They were all over the place, Torquay, Paignton, even in Stratford had an initial training wing. We spent about 10 weeks there, square bashing, a bit of instruction, and then went to a holding camp in Manchester, waiting for a ship to take us over there. And eventually, after 6 weeks there, while it rained all the time nearly, up north to go on board a ship, American troop ship that had come over. There were several of them with American escort, and we were all packed onto one of them, and off we went to America. Landed in New York. We didn't see anything of New York really, because we just got off the ship, onto a train, and up to Canada, Moncton, another holding camp, waiting for the training camp to finish off one course and ready for our new course to go down there. And from Moncton, where we spent another 4 or 5 weeks, we got on board a train, and 4 days and nights on this train went down to Oklahoma. At times at walking pace, we got off and walked alongside at times, and ended up in this little place called Ponca City, which was number 6 British Flying Training School. All American instructors. We had a handful of RAF people, a flight lieutenant who was more or less in charge of us all, a couple of warrant officers who taught us armaments and that type of thing. And we were there for nearly 6 months.
Okay, one more question about the trip going over there. Can you remember, firstly, the name of the ship that you were on?
No.
Okay, and can you just tell me what the conditions were like? Like, how many men were on board that ship, and what the transport, what it was like, the journey?
We were pretty well packed on board, really, because they were, although there were 2 or 3 ships going back empty, it was obviously more convenient for them to put us all on board one ship. And so we were crammed on board, really. And my main impression was that the eating arrangements, because, you know, having come from rationed England, there we were being fed American style. And it was quite remarkable, really, the change in diet at that time. We were several days going over there, because, you know, a fairly slow method with all the escorts and that sort of thing. And I suppose it must have taken us about a week to get over there. No real problems. As I say, New York, we barely saw it at all.
Okay, and the reason I asked that was because when I spoke to various American pilots who transferred to Africa aboard ships, they were saying that the conditions were cramped below decks. Obviously, some people couldn't cope with the sea, so they were seasick.
Mm.
Then you had the smell of sick. Then you had the lots of people smoking, so you had the sick and the smoking. And they were only allowed to go on deck, I think, for an hour at a time, but it was only at night time. They couldn't go up on the daytime.
Yes.
They had so many limitations on them, and they said it wasn't a very enjoyable experience.
No, I don't remember any problems like that, really. We were certainly fairly crowded, and the particularly the sleeping arrangements were not ideal, but we coped, really, and I suppose most of us were fairly young. We did have a number of RAF people who had remustered from other trade who were older. They were scraping the barrel, really, to get everyone they could into air crew. People in reserved occupations could actually leave if they joined air crew. And they were appealing for people from the army and other elsewhere to transfer to become air crew. So we were a pretty motley bunch, really. But I don't think we had any problem. I don't remember any problem with smoking or anything like that, because we couldn't get hold of any liquor anyway, so no problem there.
Okay. So you go to basic training in America, in Oklahoma. Do you remember much about the base? Can you tell me what the base was like? Was it a large base, small base? Was it in the fields? What was the base like?
It's quite small, really. It was a grass airfield. It had a strip of runway because a civilian airline used it once a day, and we'd see this aircraft, something like a Dakota, would come straight in, no bother with the circuit or anything like that, straight in onto the runway and then straight off again. But that was over one side of the airfield. We were we had about four large barrack blocks, timber, where we were. We occupied two of them, and the others were used as classrooms and messing facilities, that sort of thing. It was just a grass airfield. It was quite small, really.
Okay. I'm probably going to jump backwards and forwards on certain questions, if that's okay. But you know, when you enlisted, I'm sorry, I'm going to go back to being enlisted, but when you enlisted and you were assessed, what sort of things did they assess you as? Did you have to do any, pilot control testing or any? What sort of things did you get assessed?
No, nothing in that way at all. It was mainly a matter of standard of education, some arithmetic tests and that sort of thing, and I think they were also concerned from an interview point of view as much as anything. And of course, there was also the medical, which were fairly stringent. I remember one thing that we had to do was to blow up a column of mercury and to hold it. I think that was to test lung power or something like that, or lung capacity, and that some people had difficulty with that. But yes, it was quite stringent, really, and yet surprisingly, they did accept people who had some slight eyesight deficiency, because we had one man on the course who had to wear corrective goggles when he went flying. So they were lenient in that way. We didn't all have to be 20/20 sort of thing.
Okay. Mm. Well, look, we'll go to training. When you started training, do you remember this is in Oklahoma. I presume that's where you started training.
Well, when we left ITW, we went to an airfield at the side of the aircraft manufacturers at Brough, where we did what they called a grading school. And the Tiger Moths, we were expected to go solo inside 12 hours, which most of us managed in, say, 8. But we were only there about 10 days. And then we went to Manchester to wait to go to over there. In America, we went on to a rather more modern biplane, which was made by the big people over there. Boeing, yes. Oh, it was a Boeing, yes, yes. Stearman, they called it. A bit more substantial, but a biplane, fixed wing, fixed undercarriage. We did use that for the first 100 hours. And then we went on to Harvard's, which is the very noisy aeroplane that I still see around, retractable undercarriage monoplane, for the remaining 100 hours. We did 200 altogether. And if we survived that, because they were fairly stringent there, about a third of us were chucked off the course. They were sent back to America, where they became bomb aimers, possibly that type of thing. They apparently didn't have the aptitude to fly an airplane.
So in the 6 months that you were in Oklahoma, you started training on Stearman's, then you moved on to the T6.
Onto the Harvard,
onto the Harvard T6, which in a way, it almost sounds like you were having American training rather than British training, because most of the pilots that I knew from America had the exact same route through their training.
Yes.
So what difference, or how did it feel to go from the Tiger Moth, which from what I've seen and experienced is 30 miles an hour and you're in the air. No, it's not quite that good, but very, very light, very easy to take off, to go into the American planes, which were considerably more powerful, I would have thought, than the Tiger.
Well, no, I think the Stearman wasn't too far removed from the Tiger Moth. It was just a bit more substantial than the Tiger Moth, possibly a bit more modern, you could say, but the controls were the same, the instruments were the same, and I don't think you could say there'd be much difference between the American style of training and what would be the RAF style of training. They were civilian instructors, some are better than others. I was lucky, I had a big man, your size, Earl, what was the other name? Earl something, yes. But he was a magnificent chap, really, and so the initial training on the Stearman was quite enjoyable, really. When we got into Harvard, I was unfortunate enough to have a chap who wasn't quite so understanding, and if we were on a cross country or anything like that and you wandered about 2 degrees off course, you'd find yourself upside down, and but we survived, or at least two-thirds of us did.
Well, one of the phrases that I've heard used by, and I'm going to talk about American pilots when I talk, because I've interviewed lots, but one of the phrases they came up with is that they were in fear of being washed out. Now, I know that's what you're saying about being thrown off the course.
Yes.
Were there any instances that you remember during your training that you were concerned about, or maybe thought you were on the edge of being washed out?
No, I can't really. I can't really recall that I felt that way. It wasn't.
Did you have any difficulties in certain procedures or certain manoeuvres that took a lot more time and practice for you, or took a lot of work on your part?
No, I'm not being very helpful here.
That's all right.
No, I can't think of any particular difficulties, but we did have one or two instances of unauthorised low flying, for instance, and that inevitably meant they'd be washed out, that sort of thing. So it was a matter of behaving yourself to some extent. We were lucky with the weather there, you see, that was a great help. And if we were sent off on a solo cross-country, for instance, if we got lost, well, we just look for the nearest railway line or town or something, and the name was usually painted on the roof of the building, sort of thing, so you could tell where you were. So it was fairly easy in that way.
If only the Germans had done that. If only the Germans had done
that. Ah, well, yes, 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 absolutely.
I want to go back one more step again. Do you remember the first time that you took control of that Tiger Moth, the first time you took control of a plane?
Ah, yes, a bit frightening. Yes, I suppose the takeoff wasn't too bad. It was coming into land that was probably more worrying than anything else. But it was just a case of a takeoff, a quick circuit round and a straight in sort of thing. We'd practiced that a number of times with the instructor on board, and I think it was just a case of doing as we had done previously.
So, one of the manoeuvres I've heard of in the past that people who flew Tiger Moths had difficulty with was stalls. When you had an instructor with you, did you ever have to practice stalls? Were they challenging?
Oh yes, yes. They would show us what happened in a stall. I think the Tiger Moth was probably fairly well behaved, but some aircraft, of course, are a bit nasty when you stall. They just flip you straight over, sort of thing.
But you didn't. But no issues with that. It was a case of listening to the instructor.
Yes, yes, yes.
I know you were saying Earl was a great instructor in America. Were there any instructors that you remember who gave you a piece of advice that stuck with you through your tour?
Not really. I can't think of any yet, really. No, I can't think of anything very outstanding, really.
Okay. I asked that one because one of the fighter pilots that I spoke with was telling me he was approaching an aircraft from behind to shoot it down. And as he approached, he had the voice of his instructor come into his head, and it said, when you're ready to shoot down an aircraft, make sure you check your six first, because you can guarantee there might be somebody there waiting to shoot you down. And he said he looked over his shoulder, and there was an enemy just coming in to shoot him.
Oh, yeah.
So he managed to break away. Yeah. It was just one of those pieces of information that stuck with him through the whole of his tour. Just how to ask.
Yes.
During your training, once you went to Harvard's, what happened after Harvard's?
Back to England. I can remember the name of that ship because we came back unescorted. Like the Queen's, it was a French liner being built for the South American cruise trade, and she was fast enough. And that was the Louis Pasteur. A French ship. Having been built for the tropics, it wasn't all that comfortable really, but we managed anyway, and it was a fairly quick return.
And was that really reasonably about the same amount of people on board crammed in again?
Oh yes. We sailed from Canada, having from Ponca City gone back to America by train. And spent a couple of weeks or so there waiting for the Louis Pasteur to be available.
Okay, so when you arrive back in England, where do you go then?
Well, we went to Harrogate first while they sorted out where we were to be sent. And I went first of all to Wiltshire. South Cerny was the airfield. We were converting onto twin-engined aircraft. And again, we were using a grass airfield, and we only did a small number of hours there to fly the Oxford. And from there, back to Stafford, near Stafford, to fly Wellingtons. So that was still in service as a bombing aircraft, that was. And that's where we crewed up with four other members of air crew. So we were five in the crew at that stage.
What were your impressions of the Wellington bomber?
Oh, very good, really. Except that in this country, most training aircraft were worn out. I remember on one occasion we were sent off in this Wellington for a night flight along the east coast to give practice to the searchlight and anti-aircraft crews. But getting on board the aircraft, there was a notice on the dash, this aircraft has a distorted main spar, and rate of turn is limited to rate one, you see, which really is 15 degrees of bank and takes you about a quarter of an hour to go around 360 degrees. And there we were, switched to fly along the northeast coast in a blaze of searchlights while doing 15 degree bank of turn, trying to get out of them, which was nonsense, of course. But that was a worn out aircraft, you see. And they were similar all the way through training.
Wow, okay. So during your time aboard the Wellington, it's only because I like the Wellington bomber, during your time aboard the Wellington, did you have any incidents that you remember that stand out for you? I know you were saying about that 1 degree but were there any other problems that you had? Were there any problems that you had with worn out aircraft or issues that you had during your time training?
Well, there was only that one instance where we had the restriction on bank of turn. We did go on two trips into France while we were there. We were towards the end of the training there, delivering leaflets in the Paris area. Well, we all set off on this one occasion, and all got back except, but there were two aircraft still to return. And of course, when they landed, great excitement. They'd both been involved with a fighter, a German fighter, so they said. But it turned out that they'd been shooting at each other, you see. No hits at all, so they weren't very good.
Yeah. That would have been challenging, trying to explain that one. Because obviously they know the guns have been fired, and they're like, what were you firing at?
Yeah.
Both have thought, yeah.
Yeah, they got rid of all their ammunition.
and missed. No hits.
everything was missed, yeah.
Wow. Yeah. Okay, so after Wellington's, did you progress onto anything else before you finished your training?
Yes, we went from there to heavy conversion unit onto Fours. Halifaxes. Again, the aircraft were worn out. We were expected to do a certain number of night cross-country flights while we were there, but we didn't complete any of them because we lost an engine. Engine failed on all of them. That was a problem, I think, generally, with training aircraft.
So every mission that you flew in the Halifax, I mean, were you flying?
Yes.
Tell me what happens when you're flying and that happens. You know, if you can give me an example of one of those flights, you're just cruising along and then what happens? Mm.
Well, we had, when we joined the heavy con unit with Halifaxes, we gained the other two members of the crew, the engineer and the mid-upper gunner. And during these cross countries, the engineer would be watching the performance of the engines and so forth. And if it got to the point where one of them was misbehaving, he would tell me, and it was a case of then deciding whether to shut it down and feather the propeller, which we did, of course. And there was little point in pursuing the rest of the flight on three engines. There was no point in running any risk, so it was a matter of returning to base early.
And did landing on three engines cause any problems?
No. Unloaded, of course, the aircraft had no problem with that.
Okay. And just because I don't know, when you return to base with three engines, do you have to call in and do they send out the fire crews?
Well, we would tell them that we were on three, and of course, I don't think they were made any special arrangements, but they were always on standby anyway. And it was just a case of adjusting the landing arrangements, really, from the aircraft.
Mm. Okay. So after the Halifaxes and finishing your training on there, then what happens?
Well, we then went to what they called Lank Finishing School, where we, again, if you like, familiarised ourselves with the Lancaster. We were only there quite a short time, really, probably 2 weeks or so. And then we were onto the squadron.
Okay. Can you tell me what your feelings were the first time you saw the Lancaster compared to the other aircraft you flew?
Oh, very impressed, really, yes. The Lancaster, magnificent aeroplane, but it was very small inside. And I had a friend who actually did his operations on Halifax, and he always used to say the Lancaster was a death trap, because if you had to get out in a hurry when you were in the air, it was very difficult, particularly for the pilot, because to get to the pilot's position, you had to clamber over the main spar, which was sort of about that high. There you are, in all flying gear and boots and parachute harness and all that sort of thing, clambering over this darn thing, and you'd have to do that to get out of the aeroplane. Whereas the Halifax, well, you almost hold a dance in the thing.
Right. So with the Lancaster itself, I mean, how much bigger was it than the aircraft you'd flown before?
It was about the same size as the Halifax, of course, but it was a lot bigger than even the Wellington, having double the number of engines at a start, of course, but it was considerably bigger in size, heavier, but it still performed as well, if not better, than the Wellington.
And you said it was only a short time before you went to your squadron.
Mm.
But what in the time that you were doing the training with the Lancaster on the finishing, what procedures, what did you have to do for those few days?
Well, the usual thing, you'd be with another pilot initially to circuit some bumps and get familiarised with the aeroplane. Not myself only, just the rest of the crew as well would be familiarising themselves with their particular spot in the aircraft and what they were handling. And then it was a case of going solo again to some extent and carrying out the routine that we were expected to do again, which was flying at height and navigating around a bit.
All right, so what was the Lancaster like to fly?
Very easy, really. It had one bad habit, and that was it would swing to the left on takeoff. I think that's the rotation of the engines as much as anything. So pilot and engineer had to be on the ball and correct it, because if you didn't, it would get to the point where you couldn't get out of it. The momentum would increase, and you were out of control. We actually had that happen on operations. Not with us, but with another aircraft.
Did you see that happen?
Yes. We were in the usual lineup, waiting to get onto the runway, and this aircraft took off. He didn't correct the swing. It swung off the runway. The undercarriage collapsed, and the side of the runway burst into flames. The crew got out and ran like hell, of course. But the ground control were very good. They got the rest of us off at the side of this burning aircraft, which was fortunate, really. And about 10 minutes later, after we'd circled round and passed over the aircraft on our way, the rear gunner reported it had blown up. We were, where the squadron was right up to a built-up area on the outskirts of Grimsby. And a tremendous amount of damage was caused. Roofs off, windows out, all sorts of things. And they got everyone up, picking up bits of metal off the runway so we could get down again in the morning. There's still a hole, by the way, by the side of the runway.
Do you remember how long it was from the point you joined the RAF to actually when you got your wings?
Mm-hmm. To getting on the squadron?
Yes.
Yes. Well, it was early 43 that I finished in America, and it then took me another year to get on the squadron. You know, you spend as much time hanging about as you do doing anything, really, waiting for courses to become available and to go and take part in them. Having left America in the spring of 43, we were then April 44 getting on the squadron.
How did it feel once you got your wings?
Oh, very pleased, delighted, really. Yes, yes. Yeah. We were, well, I tell you all, most of us became sergeants. There were a few commissioned there, and then I think they were mainly people who'd been in the university air squadrons or something like that. There were just a handful of them. And the course started off, I think, with about 54 of us, and there were just about 31 qualified. The rest had been washed out, as you say.
Well, you said that you were only at that finishing school for the Lancasters for a short time.
Mm.
Can you tell me literally about the point where you hear that you're going to join 100 Squadron.
Mm.
Can you tell me, so you've been training, how did that actually happen? Was it a case of you finished and now you're waiting to hear, or was it you're just still training, and then one night it's, oh, you're joining the squadron tomorrow. I mean, can you tell me how what happened with that?
Yes, well, that's how it was, really. I don't think there's any real excitement about it or anything, but you felt that at last we're getting to do what we're supposed to be doing. We hadn't finished training, we were still training even when we got onto the squadron, really, because we were, what, I suppose, 10 days before we did actually went on operation. And it was a case of familiarising ourselves with the location of the airfield for a start, and continuing to get used to the aircraft.
Can you tell me how you actually found out you were joining 100 Squadron?
It was in put up in board order sort of thing on the notice board, and that was it. And you had your rail warrant, and off you went.
Yeah, I was thinking, you're training at finishing school, and then do they say, oh, you need to go into the operations room because there are orders, or how were you directed to know that you were going to join?
Well, it was routine that you would check on the notice board, even on the squadron. That's how you find out if you were operating, you see. No one actually came along and said, right, you're going to so-and-so. It had all been decided, and it was a notice put up, and you went from there to packing your stuff and getting your rail warrant and setting off.
So how did it feel when you arrived? It was Grimsby you went to, was it? Did it feel when you arrived at Grimsby, actually joining an operating squadron?
Very much the new boy, really. After the few days when we were familiarising ourselves with the place, the squadron had a policy of new crews going out with an experienced crew. They called it a second dicky trick, really. And it wasn't the complete crew, because you couldn't get them all on board for a start. But I went with this chap, Flight Lieutenant Sheriff, who was flying NNAN, which I later flew on a number of occasions. He was on his second tour. He'd been in the Middle East on his first tour, and he was just finishing his own tour. And with two or three of my chaps, we went with him on our first trip, which was a fairly sort of non-event, really, because it was just a trip out to some marshalling yard or something like that, I think. Others, unfortunately, had a more exciting experience. A friend of mine who lived in Bromsgrove, they were shot up, actually, on their second dinghy trip.
Okay, so that was your first operational flight.
Yes.
What or when? I don't need the dates so much, but the first time that you took control of the aircraft, can you tell me about that flight, that mission, the first time you were in charge of the aircraft? Mm.
Well, you'd see that you were down for operations, and see what time the briefing was, that sort of thing. And the routine was to go out to the aircraft, check it over, if necessary, do a test flight, but make sure the aircraft was ready for that operation. Then you'd go back and have your final meal, and then go to briefing. And it then depended on what the target was as to what your feelings were, depending on whether it was a dodgy target or not.
Okay, so the first mission you fly, that you're actually at the controls. Can you just talk me through that, if you can remember what that first mission was like? I would have thought there'd have been you'd have felt a lot of responsibility.
Yes. Well, as I say, we'd do all the pre-flight checks, and then have our pre-flight meal, then turn up for briefing, and find out where we were going, and we'd get all the usual information from the various experts, the gunnery chap, navigation, weatherman, and we then collect all our gear, our parachutes and anything else that we needed, and wait for the bus to take us out to the aircraft. And I think you're so busy that you didn't really have a lot of time to think, oh, I'm not very happy about this one, but obviously some are more hazardous than others. And but on the whole, it was a case of, well, here we are, this is where we're going, and we'll get ready for it.
So what was your first mission? Do you remember?
I can't, but I think I've got a note of it here.
Okay.
I was unfortunate enough to lose my logbook, which I was very annoyed about, really. My second dicky trip was to a coastal gun battery, because we were in the pre-invasion period by then, of course.
Yeah.
And when we went as a full crew, it was to the same target, because to this coastal gun battery. Fairly short trip, really, about 4 hours. So it was on the French coast, and just 4 hours. I was lucky enough to, a chap in Grimsby got all this information for me from the record. So while it didn't have the information that was in my logbook, it did give me quite a lot of information, really. And yes, it was an uneventful trip, really.
You were operational during the build-up and around D-Day. Mm,
yes.
Were you aware of it?
We knew it was imminent, should we say, because we weren't allowed off camp. We weren't allowed any outside telephone calls. And all our mail was being censored as well. So there was a clampdown on the place, and I suppose it applied everywhere. And we didn't know the day that it was going to take place, but we actually flew the night before. I forget where that was too, but we only knew that the operation was on our way back, because we could see the shipping in the channel.
In that case then, after D-Day, what were the feelings within the base and with you as well, that you knew the invasion had started?
Well, we were pretty exhausted in a way, because we were flying around the clock. apart from that, I think it was a case of, well at last we're getting somewhere, and let's hope it goes well.
Now, I was looking in the records, and June the 6th was a full moon. You flew on a full moon. You flew on full moon missions. Now, I've understood it's called Bomber's Moon.
Mm.
Was that a worry to pilots, flying under a full moon?
It wasn't a very good idea, really. I don't think it would worry us on this particular trip that we were on, because we weren't into the concentration of anti-aircraft and fighters on that sort of trip. They did appear from time to time, but there wasn't the concentration of them, so it wouldn't have been a big worry. But we wouldn't have been very happy if it had been a major operation sort of thing into Germany.
Do you remember if you flew any full moon missions into Germany?
I can't recall any, no.
Okay. Good. So, I'm going to make a presumption now, and correct me if I'm wrong, but were most or all of your missions at night?
No.
Okay. Yeah. Could you tell me which missions, not necessarily where they were to, but why some missions were flown in daytime?
Yes. We actually did a couple in support of the army in Normandy. Either at dusk or dawn sort of thing for the army, and not a great height, but we had to be very careful about where we let go our bombs. We had to make, there was a bomb line, and we had to make sure we were over the bomb line before we got rid of them. There was another which was a long trip in daylight, and we were sent to this oil refinery in the estuary of the river Gironde. That's the river that goes to Bordeaux. That was an 8-hour round trip in daylight, and we were expected to fly below 1,000 feet all the way. We're supposed to keep out of radar, German radar, you see, but it's a bit dodgy keeping below 1,000 feet with a large number of aircraft around. Actually, one aircraft flew underneath another bomber that we saw, and they collided. The bottom one went into the Bay of Biscay, and the other chap dropped his bombs and went home. That one aircraft lost, that was the only one that was lost. Of course, when we got to near to the target, we would climb to bombing height and get rid of them. Then the same on the way back. So it was a fairly arduous trip, really, 8 hours, even in daylight.
And on a mission like that in daytime, would flak have been an issue?
No, not on that one, because I don't think there's any flak at the target. We were out of the area that the Germans protected with flak.
Well, yeah, well, I'm going to ask you a different question. I haven't written this one down, but compared to flying at night, I was going to say, did you prefer flying in the daytime? But obviously it's got its against, because you're more visible, but would it be easier with target? So did you prefer flying in the daytime to the nighttime?
Oh, nighttime and operations. You're very exposed in daylight, and it was bad enough at night, but when they could see you and be sure that they could see you, it was quite a different thing. And of course, you would also see all the other aircraft around you, which is a bit of a hazard as well. At night time, you knew they were there, you felt they were there, because you'd get into their slipstream and it'd rock you about a bit. We were born and bred for night flying, I think, as opposed to the Americans.
Okay. Well, look, in the missions that you flew, I've read many stories about bombers who flew at night. Were you ever coned or hit by searchlights in any of the missions you flew?
We were, yes, we did get into searchlights, but we were very lucky that, although the sort of flak was all over the place, we had some slight damage, but nothing that caused any problems. Not while we were in the air anyway. The problem was later on when they were trying to put the damage right. So we were extremely lucky in that way. Searchlights, well, they were there, and you just hoped you didn't get into one of their radar-directed ones, which were very difficult to get out of.
And that, you never got hit by a radar one?
No.
But did you get illuminated at any point by a flash, by a searchlight?
Mm-hmm.
Were you illuminated?
Oh, yes.
And what was that like for you as a pilot?
A bit shattering, really, because you've lost your night vision for a start, and you're trying hard to concentrate on your flying and trying to look at your instruments, that sort of thing, when you're in this quite intensive blaze of light.
And how bright was it?
Oh, very considerable, yes. Uncomfortable, really, to be there any length of time, yes.
So how did you get out of the light?
Pretty violent manoeuvres, really. You depending on what stage of the operation it was, really, because if you had got rid of your bomb load, you obviously were hampered to some extent by that weight. But diving and a swift turn sort of thing would get them thinking you were going one way and they were going the other sort of thing.
And what was it like to experience that?
Oh, to get out of it, great relief that was.
Wow, okay.
Yeah.
Have you ever heard of stories, well, they say stories, have you ever heard of scarecrow flak?
Yes. Yes, we talked. It was fairly common talk, really, but I don't think it really existed. I can't really imagine how they would get anything like that up into the air anyway, to be near us. I mean, it'd be a pretty big thing, wouldn't it, to get up there? I think it was in a way a bit of self-preservation, if you like. You would see these enormous explosions, you would think, oh, scarecrow gone off, but it wasn't actually, it was a couple of bombers colliding or being blown up with flak.
And you experienced that?
Oh, we saw them, yes.
Were they close to you?
No, we didn't. No, they were a little way away, but they were still close enough to be disturbing. Yes, because the stream was fairly concentrated, or should have been. Mm.
Yeah. Okay, look, weather. Grimsby, I would think, is not one of the warmest places in the country. Now, I know that your tour was just after the winter, sort of, before the end of the start of the next one. But yes. Do you remember any, not necessarily incidents, but do you remember what the weather was like at Grimsby and if it caused any problems for the missions that were due to be flown?
Yes, we did have problems. In fact, we on a number of occasions, the weather was bad enough for us to go out over the North Sea to get down to landing height. We were fortunate enough to be able to do that, really. The only problem was that when we came back to the coast, we had to dodge a Navy radio station with its masts. We didn't want to fly into those, but we could get back down to low enough for landing. And we were experienced enough, I suppose, to cope with landing from a reduced height. We were, on one occasion, the weather was bad enough for us all to be sent off to another airfield to land. And that was a bit chaotic, really, because we were in Nan and we were all circling around this airfield and they called in Nan and of course I got into the circuit and turned onto the runway and there was another aircraft in front of me, so I had to go around again, you see. Did that three times before we got down. And next morning when we went back to the aircraft, there were three Nans lined up, you see, all from different squadrons.
Okay. I don't know what RAF Grimsby's like, so coming into land at RAF Grimsby, would you be arriving mainly at dawn there? So would it be daybreak when you were landing, or was it always night time?
No, I think we would be mostly we were down in daylight, yes.
So when you come into approach, were there any, I know you say you had to be diverted that time, but were there any times when the weather was bad but you were still expected to land?
Yes, that was when we went out to let down over the North Sea.
Mm. And so when you're on approach in that sort of condition, is that really difficult to concentrate?
No. We'd get into the circuit as usual, of course, and the actual landing approach, we'd be down to about 300 feet anyway, which was the normal height, and we'd obviously be clear of the weather by then, otherwise we'd have gone elsewhere. This would have been any worse.
Okay. So you return from the mission and you climb off the plane. There are going to be days when you have rest and relaxation, R&R. What did you do on your days off when you weren't flying?
Well, we'd go into Grimsby sometimes, yes. They had a theatre there which they used to put shows on, variety shows, that sort of thing. We'd go to that. We were actually on a bus into Grimsby, you see, we were so close. But I can't really think. I think we just lazed around the place and we'd probably go to the pub in the evening, which was very handy nearby.
Do you have any idea what that pub was called? Do you remember what the pub was called?
I can't, no. It's age and this is, you know.
It's a pub. I do like it.
Yeah.
Were you married at the time?
No. We had said that we'd wait until the end of the war, but we actually waited until I'd finished an operation. So we married in October 44.
So that was after you finished your tour?
Yes. We finished in early August.
And how? When did you meet?
In 1940.
Okay.
She lived with her family in the Hall Green area of Birmingham, but with the bombing, they decided they'd go and live with some relatives they had in Stratford. And that's where I met them, really, because the ATC used to hold dances and that sort of thing, you see, amongst other things, and there she was, you see.
And what was her name?
Brenda Holmes.
Mm. Okay. Do you remember where you proposed?
I think it was a case of mutual consent more than anything else.
That sounds almost like, shall we? Yeah, okay, let's get on with it. Like,
yeah. Okay. I mean, you see, from that meeting, it went on a couple of years, really, including the time I was in America, you see, and so... it was a case of correspondence then with these air letters and things, which I only recently got rid of.
Treasure. Okay. Even though you were in a relationship, did the girls in the pubs in the area, in the towns, did they like the pilots? Did they like the air crews?
Oh, yeah. Particularly in America. I mean, we weren't even pilots by then, but... Now, you see, we came down from Canada after this four-hour trip. We arrived at Ponca City station about 2 o'clock in the morning in the middle of a thunderstorm. The platform was packed with people at 2 o'clock in the morning, mostly young girls, mind you. And we get onto coaches out to the airfield and the dratted phone was ringing. We got a phone in the barrack block, you see. That was ringing. They were ringing up already to date these guys.
And you're, I can't, I'm taken, you're saying.
Well, they were tremendously welcoming and in every way possible, the Americans were. From the actual sort of girlfriend point of view, I can't really remember sort of being greatly involved, though. There were occasions when a group of us would sort of be entertained so on, but not having the inclination, I suppose, as much as anything, had a great deal to do with it.
Now, I'm going to stay with girls, but bear with me on this. I know from other crews that I've spoken to on bombers that there were, and I'm not going to say prostitutes because they weren't, they were just girls who started relationships with a member of a crew, and then that crew would fly out, and that crew wouldn't come back.
Yeah.
And then maybe she would start a relationship with another pilot or crew member. That crew would fly out and not come back. Were you aware of some girls who were considered to be bad luck? Were there any time, I mean, not for you, but I mean, did you know of girls who were branded bad luck?
Well, I've read about it. Of course, they were regarded as jinxes, weren't they, really? But I can't say that I was aware of anything at all. Really, not being into the social activity of that sort, I think we were only two police sort of to be in the pub, and I can't recall getting involved in any other way, really.
Okay. Mm. I'm going to stick on luck. Did you have any good luck charms, or did you carry anything with you in your flights that you thought were...
No. No.
Well, did you know if anybody had anything unusual? Did you know of anybody who carried anything unusual as a good luck charm?
No, no. No, just...
They trusted in you. They just trusted in you, that was it.
Yes.
Okay, well, bit of a out there question. Were you religious, or did you have any faith?
Oh, yes, yes. Not strongly, but yes. I remember my mother saying that she always knew I would come through, because at one time she was involved with spiritualism, and that's where I get my name from, because she was recommended by one of the mediums, I think. So she said she always knew I'd come through, but I wasn't strongly religious at the time, no, although I'd sort of been in the choir at one time. Yes.
Mm. What choir?
At the school in Stratford, yes. Mm.
Okay. Mm. It's a question I have to ask, and I have read the reports of your missions, and it does, when I say lucky, bear with me when I say it looks as though you're quite lucky.
Oh, yeah. Very.
Did you have any friends or crew that you knew who were killed in missions? And if you did, how did you cope with that?
Well, there was one where one of our second dickie crews, by the way, we had a bit of an unfortunate experience with this crew, and it was normal for the bomb aimer to go down into his bombing position as we were taxiing out to the runway and make sure everything was okay down there. And then when we were ready to turn on the runway, I'd call him back because it was a dangerous position on takeoff. And on this occasion, he came back and we turned onto the runway. We opened up the throttles and we got one hell of a racket in our headphones. No idea what it was, but we just couldn't communicate in any way. And the engineer and myself, we did everything with sign language, really. It got off safely. Once we were clear of the ground, I got hold of the wireless operator and said, sort out this racket, will you? Which he did. And the idiot of a bomb aimer had left his helmet in the bombing position with his microphone switched on. So we were entertained by four Merlins, you see, while we were taking off. And this was shortly after this one aircraft had swung off the runway and burst into flames. It wasn't a very happy occasion, really. Now, unfortunately, they were lost a few operations afterwards, and we weren't really surprised at that. Perhaps the bomber was the stupid one of the crew, but we got the wrong impression of them.
When it comes to the loss of colleagues, I mean, how do you find the strength and reserve to carry on?
Well, I think you noticed it more when, say, you were in the mess having your meals and that sort of thing, and briefing, a crew that you were expecting just weren't there. But it was a very sort of clinical business in Bomber Command, because when a crew was missing, other air crew moved in, not air crew, other members of the RAF moved in, got all their belongings, and it was all sanitised and cleaned up, and another crew filled the spot. It was quite a clinical business, really.
I know that some crew members were removed from flight because of LMF.
Mm. Terrible.
Were you aware of any that were removed? Not necessarily yours, but
no.
Like a moral fibre.
Yes. That was a disgraceful way of dealing with it, really, by the RAF. The Americans had a much better way. They sent people to hospital. But they were disgraced completely in front of everyone. We didn't have any occasion on the squadron while I was there, but we knew about it. Of course, I think to some extent it must have had an influence on people who were uncertain and probably encouraged them or forced them to carry on regardless.
I mean, it's been described as the worst way of being taken out of operations by having that put down next to your name, because basically saying you're a coward.
Oh yes, yes. Well, it wasn't just having it on your record. You were stripped of your rank and you were disgraced. You were given the rottenest job possible, sort of thing, and treated just as an outcast.
All right, now back to your missions. I'm going to read this because as I was writing notes out, this is what I wrote. So I understand one group tried to get as many bombs onto aircraft as possible, usually loading more than the equivalent five group squadron. Do you know anything about having the maximum load on your aircraft, or maybe even more?
Didn't notice it really. I mean, the load was enough anyway. You invariably, if you're going, say, into the Ruhr or somewhere like that, you'd have a cookie. That's the 4,000 pounder. If you've seen those, you know what they're like. They're just a big steel canister without any fins or anything like that. They just tumble and blow everyone's roofs off. There was certainly a change in the behaviour of the aircraft once it was loaded. And it wasn't just the bomb load, of course. I mean, you've probably got 1,500 or 2,000 gallons of petrol on board. Well, that in itself is a fair load. You know, I mean, 1,000 gallons of petrol, that's 10,000 pounds, roughly, in weight. That's as much as your bomb load, just for 1,000 gallons. That's probably half what you'll be carrying.
So with the bomb loads on your aircraft, was it always, as far as you remember, the maximum that you could carry?
As far as I'm aware, yes, yes. There was no point in going unless you're taking all you could take, really.
And what was it? I mean, yeah, one of the things I haven't asked you, I've asked you about your first mission, but when your aircraft is fully laden with armament, how much more difficult is it to take off and fly than when you're...
Well, the takeoff's the difficult part, because, for instance, we had one runway, which was north-south. If we were flying north into over Grimsby, the local people knew when we were flying and taking off over Grimsby, and most of them didn't go to bed until we'd gone, because literally we'd be over Grimsby about 300 feet, staggering. The takeoff was difficult, and you literally were staggering for until you got up to about 300 feet. You'd get the flaps off and get to a proper height, climbing speed.
Do you remember if you were told about any emergency procedures when you were taking off? So, for example, let's say you lost an engine on takeoff. Mm. What procedures would you be expected to go through?
Well, it depended how advanced the takeoff was, really. If it was early in the takeoff, you'd probably shut down and try and stay on the ground. But if you got past the point of no return, you just had to hope you could get away. It'd be very difficult, fully loaded with three engines, I can tell you. Yeah.
Did you ever remember, not for you again, like I say, but do you remember of any incidences of aircraft being lost after takeoff?
No, apart from what I've told you about, yes.
Okay. You flew the majority of your missions aboard ND-644.
Mm.
I'm told it was named Naughty Nan.
Oh, didn't know that. No, we just called her Nan, that was it.
Right. I wondered if you remember it being written on the side of the aircraft anywhere.
No, I can't. No.
It's a shame.
She was a bit ancient by the time we got her, but she was very well equipped, and all her systems worked very well, and that was what I think helped us.
Squadron call signs. I know that Grimsby had the nickname, or was the call sign was Name Tab. Do you remember any other call signs in your group?
No.
Did you remember Name Tab?
No.
Okay.
No. It's terrible, isn't it, you know?
All right, so missions then. Of the missions that you flew, are there any that stick out in your mind?
Mm.
Could you tell me of any missions or any that you remember most?
Mm, yes. Well, I remember one that didn't actually take place. We were briefed. We were on the list as spare crew. Always had a spare crew in case aircraft became US or anything like that. And we were spare crew on this occasion. And briefing, and I can't remember what the target would have been, but I wasn't very happy about it. And that was unusual because I used to sort of say, oh, well, it's so-and-so, we've been there before, so. But this one, there was something about it I didn't like. Anyway, I've got through briefing and I was standing chatting to someone, and one of my lads came over and said a mid-upper in another crew had gone sick and they wanted our jock, our lad, to take his place, and they said, we're not having that. I said, if anybody's going, we're all going. I thought, oh my God, you know, I don't want to go on this one. So I said, okay, I'll see the flight commander and fix it. So that's what we did. We replaced the crew. They became spare crew. Fortunately, the op was scrubbed. I don't know whether it was weather or something, but we didn't actually go on that trip. So that was one where we didn't actually fly. We had another one. One of the Army Corporation trips in Normandy was dodgy. The weather got bad and we had to go down very low to see where we were actually bombing. And we felt our own bombs explode actually because we were so low. And then it was a case of having got rid of them to get up. We actually went straight up into cloud with everyone else milling around us. But the worst one, in a way, we were at Stuttgart. In middle of July, 44, Bomber Command went to Stuttgart three times in four nights. 100 Squadron were in the last two. And it was on the last one, we'd just lined up onto our bombing heading. The rear gunner came through and said, there's a fighter lurking behind us. And so I said, well, just hope he stays there until we get rid of this lot, sort of thing. Because if we'd had to divert, we'd have had to gone right round again and to come back in on the same heading. And so we were holding our breath. Suddenly the engineer who was standing at the side of me, she said, look, and pointed to yourself. I couldn't see a damn thing, it was pitch dark, you see. But I instinctively shoved the nose of the aircraft down. Another Lancaster went straight over us. We didn't see any more of the fighter that had been hanging around. I think he was as frightened as we were.
That was so a bit. Lancaster came over the top towards you?
Yes, yes. How he got into that position, I don't know, because we were all supposed to be going in the same direction. But he literally was head on. And it was sheer luck, really, that he'd seen some glimmer or something and said so, called out, and I'd instinctively shoved the nose down.
How close do you think you were?
Oh, feet, I should think. Yes. You know, there's no mistaking it was a Lancaster.
Right. That's impressive. So, yeah, and the fighter obviously decided he wasn't interested anymore.
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, we were lucky, really, in a way, because we hadn't gone off our heading, and apart from losing 200 or 300 feet, got back to height, and we carried on and didn't need to go round again. So we got rid of our bombs and off home.
Do you remember how you stayed on target? And the reason I asked that, I know there was Oboe, there was Z2S.
Mm.
But do you remember which method or system was aboard the aircraft that you flew with?
Well, once we were on our bombing heading, it was a case of heading for the markers, keeping the markers in view, sort of thing, you see, and more or less on a compass course.
Okay, so I mean, from your point of view, I know the navigator would normally be the one who was guiding the aircraft and saying, okay, we need to do this, we need to do that. But there wasn't, because I was reading about the Lorenz blind and all these sort of things where if you swayed this way, then the beam sort of like activated, and then if you swayed this way, so if you stay between the two beams, the noises would stay the same.
Mm.
And then eventually you'd reach a point where there was an arc, and then you'd know you're in the area where the bombs needed to be dropped. That was all out of your...
Mm.
Control, yes. That was all down to the navigators and
everything.
You were just...
Yeah, no, I don't think we were involved in any way, really. I mean, that probably applied to the Pathfinders. They would use that sort of equipment, but once we were at the target, we'd have the master bomber telling us what aiming point we should use, and it was a case of heading for it, and when we got to the mark, we would drop our load.
Well, I was going to say, can you just take me through a mission that you experienced? It doesn't need to be, you know, didn't need to name the mission or where the target was or anything, but could you explain to me what it was like approaching a target with searchlights and flak? And could you just explain what that's like as a pilot when you're approaching for me?
Yeah, pretty horrific, really. In fact, my navigator, he was sort of got his head down all the time. But on one operation, I forget where it was now, but he decided he'd better see what the target looked like once we were there. And so he came out of his little curtained place and took one look, and the language was quite entertaining, really, and he got back inside very quickly. He was absolutely shattered, really, to see that it was as it was, because he'd never seen it before, and he'd been flying in and out of it. But it was a bit of a build-up, really, with us. I mean, some crews, they were sort of straight into Berlin on their first op sort of thing, so they had a very high-powered introduction. But we'd had one or two other operations beforehand, and so it had built up, and when we got into the big targets in the Ruhr and Stuttgart, for instance, where there was a lot of defence, we had an introduction to it. From my point of view, and the engineer and the gunners, we were... the others were sort of busy doing their jobs, but in a way we'd become more or less accustomed to it. And it was just a case of hoping that you could go through it unscathed. I remember reading about a senior British Army officer watching Lancasters on one of the army cooperation trips. He said he couldn't believe that the Lancaster would fly through the flak as we were without deviating in some way. Well, there was no point in deviating because you didn't know where the hell the flak was going to be. If you deviated, you'd probably go straight into it. And you were on the course anyway. I mean, the whole object was to get to a certain place and get rid of your bombs. And if you started sort of trying to dodge anything, you'd end up goodness knows where.
Can you try and explain to me what it looks like and what it feels like?
Well, you would... This didn't happen in a flash. You were already approaching it. It was already there, unless you were in the very early waves. And it just got more intense as you approached it. And you just literally were busy flying the downed aircraft and making sure that everything was going on as it should be, you know, checking with the other members of the crew that they were okay, that the gunners were okay, and keeping your eyes open for anything going on around you, and also keeping your eyes open on what the aircraft was doing. So you were pretty busy in a way, and while you couldn't say you didn't think it was there, because it was there and there was no doubt about that, and it was a case of, well, you know, we've got this far, let's hope it continues. I don't think we consciously thought we're going to get it. You just get on with it.
What does flak look like at night?
Oh, brilliant flashes. Well, that's it really. Almost, well, not like fireworks, not as brilliant colours as fireworks, but almost the same.
Yeah. I was just trying to think of, with the searchlights panning through the sky, the flak's gone off. Can you actually see where the flak was? I mean, not from the flash, but I mean, can you see the smoke pots?
Oh, well, it'd be the flashes that you'd see, yes, yes. Couldn't see any smoke in the night time.
Mm. And did you, when the flak was going off, I know there were radar guided flak guns, but could you actually see flak tracking in certain areas, or was it just random?
Yes, it was just random, yeah, yes, yes. Well, it was a mass of it, really. You wouldn't see individual bursts. There'd just be a salvo of it all, you see, because, Bomber Command took goodness knows how many thousands of men and hundreds of guns, anti-aircraft guns, from Russia to try and dissuade us from going. That's our contribution, if you like, to the Russian success.
Okay. You said on one occasion your aircraft got hit by flak.
Mm.
Can you tell me a bit more about that?
We didn't know until we got down, and in fact the ground crew had looked over the aeroplane, that's when we found out. But it had damaged mainly one of the ailerons. Not enough to cause any problem with it, but it had been damaged, and so they took it off, put a new one on. The aircraft wouldn't fly straight and level. So eventually we had the Avro people along because of it, and they put a patch on the old aileron, put it back on, perfect, flew perfectly. The main wing spar was distorted, you see, so we were told, some violent manoeuvre taken place. I mean, the routine evasion from a fighter was a corkscrew, and that involved in shoving your nose down and turning quickly and then up and round and that sort of thing. So, well, you know, if you're loaded, that was a hell of a strain on the aircraft. And this probably had happened at some time in the past. But
okay, I would say that must have happened before you started flying the
aircraft. Yes, then, yes, so. Yes.
So it must have been there for a while then.
Oh yes, yes. No one knew about it, no one was aware of it.
I want to go back to one of the mission briefings that you would have had. You said to me there was different feelings depending on the mission that you were going on.
Mm.
So were there any targets that brought out a fear of, oh no?
Well, we were lucky. By the time we'd been on the squadron long enough to start operating, they'd just finished the last lot of road on Berlin, so we missed those, fortunately. But the Ruhr was always one trip that was very popular. And Stuttgart, again, you see, that's as far as Berlin. That's, 8 hours, 8.5 hour round trip to Stuttgart. So again, that wasn't very popular. We had two in successive nights. In fact, one of my friends from the training school in America was lost on one of them.
Do you remember the incident that he was lost in? Do you remember how, or do you remember how he was lost?
No. There was an association of the Bromley School that a very good secretary who kept track of the chaps who were training there, and he sent out newsletters, and this appeared in one of the newsletters that Bob Anderson had gone on this trip to Stuttgart.
Okay, in the flights that you were in the missions that you were in, I know you said that your, I think it was the engineer, spotted the Lancaster. Did you, at any point, or did any of your crew at any point, engage an enemy or see an enemy?
No. No. We never fired our guns. And we weren't the only one. I mean, this friend of mine who died a couple of years ago, it was on Halifax, he didn't fire his guns either. I mean, you only did that if you were serious about it and they were close enough for you to do any damage, because we'd only got 303s, mind you. I mean, they had very short range of effectiveness. We were up against fighters that had got blessed cannons on board, sort of thing. They could sit half a mile off and hit us. Harris wanted to put .5s in, but he was overruled.
I remember we talked about that mission to Normandy that you flew, because that was the low-flying mission. Was that attacking, if you remember, was that attacking armour, or was it just to attack whatever was on the ground or bomb anything?
Yes, I think it was a concentration of armour, yes. Yes. We did actually go to Caen itself and bomb the town, which was a bit self-defeating, really, because we made such a mess of it. There was so much rubble in the street, the tanks couldn't get through anyway.
How do you feel? But do you have to disassociate yourself from the targets that you're going to? Because if you're being told you're bombing German armour, I can imagine that being a target of the enemy. When someone says you've got to go and bomb a town, is there any different feelings to that?
Not really. It was a target. And wherever we went, there was always something that needed to be attacked, because, if you like, even Dresden, we didn't go to Dresden, and there's a lot of talk about Dresden, but Dresden, it was full of little factories turning out stuff. And it was a big rail centre anyway. There are all sorts of reasons, but mostly with marshalling yards were another popular target, sort of thing. And if we were bombing built-up areas, it's a bit like Coventry. I mean, they destroyed more living areas in Coventry than they did industrial places, I think. And that same happened to us. They talk about the Americans didn't do area bombing. Of course they did. I mean, particularly when they got to Japan. I mean, what did they do to Japan? They burnt down half of Tokyo. So a lot of the nonsense that they talk about with America and dropping a bomb in a barrel, it's pure nonsense. No, the target, there was a good reason for going there. It was either an oil refinery but the fact that the area that was devastated spread outside the actual target is one of those things, really.
That's fine, okay. Your last mission was, I'm under the impression, Fontenoy was your last mission. Did you know it was your final mission?
Yes. Well, we kept a close tally on the numbers. I got more nervous as it approached.
I mean, exactly. I was going to ask that question though. So, how do you feel? Yeah, you know it's your last mission.
Mm.
There's nothing you can do about being more careful, but you know it's your last mission. So, what was it like knowing you were flying your last mission?
Well, as I say, you start off being very nervous, and then as you progress, you become a bit more blasé about it. But again, you get towards the end and you're thinking, oh my God, two to go, sort of, oh, one to go, this is it. It could happen.
So when you get your wheels down on that last mission,
yeah,
what was it like for everybody on board?
A big sigh of relief.
I mean, was there a, you know you've landed, did you, I'm not saying celebrate, but was there a patting on backs and things like that? You know, what was it like when you finished?
Oh, yes, yeah, a sort of, you know, well, chaps, we've done it sort of thing, yeah.
Because the crew that you flew with would have all flown the same amount of missions, would they?
Oh, yes.
You was mainly your crew was together, wasn't it, for the whole mission?
Yes,
so was the mess hall very well acquainted that night?
I think, got to remember, we probably landed at, what, 4 o'clock in the morning sort of thing. Well, you then go to debriefing, then go and have a meal, and by then you're ready to get into bed. So it's worn off a bit by the next evening turns up. But no, we did have a few beers, yes.
So once you finish your tour, what then? What happens then?
Well, we were all posted away, of course. They wanted to make room for someone else. And I went to one of the so-called operation training units, as most pilots did, sort of encourage the next lot coming along. I spent some time on Transport Command, flying, I was second pilot on Yorks, which were a variation of the Lancaster in a way, a different body, flying to India and Ceylon. And then I became training wing adjutant at a place in Yorkshire where they were training RAF pilots to become civil pilots with British Overseas Airways at that time. And that was it, really.
You said Ceylon. What was the other area you said that you did training? Where were the two areas you said you did training in?
Oh, that was from Lynham.
So you were teaching people in Yorks, and they were going to be transferred on, those trainees were going to Lancasters then?
When we were in Yorks, we were just more or less flying passengers out, you see. Senior officers, Wrens even, we flew out to Ceylon. It was a passenger service, really.
Okay, and what was that like? Because I presume that's still during the war, though.
Oh, yes, yes, yes. It was pretty advanced by then. But it was like passenger flying nowadays. I mean, you take off and you sit there for 5-6 hours or so, and you land.
But I was thinking more in terms of where you went to, where you took off and where you went to.
Yes.
Because I don't know, but these were considered safe areas.
Oh, yes,
time.
Yes. Well, the route was we flew from Lynham, first of all, to Malta. And then to Cairo, and then into a spot in the Gulf called Shaiba, and then on to Bombay. And there from Bombay, we either went over India to Calcutta or down to Ceylon. And sometimes we would leave the aircraft to a crew that was already waiting there, and we would wait for the next one to come along. We'd slip a crew, sort of thing. It would take us about a week to get there, sort of thing.
What were the places that you went to like? What, do you have any memories of those areas?
Main one was Ceylon, I think, really. Of course, beaches, a lot of wrens in swimming costumes, that sort of thing, you see. So nothing but our captain.
Happy days.
We used to joke with some of them, really. We used to say, "Ah, well, never mind. We'll see you in 3 months' time when you're coming back for discharge, pregnant."
Okay, so you finish your operational training, and then once you've done that, at some point, obviously, the war in Europe finishes. Do you remember where you were when you heard the war in Europe was over?
Yeah, I think it was this place in Ossington in Yorkshire where we were training for BOAC. But I no. Yes, that I was. Yes, that was where we heard it was over, and that was where I was discharged from. I was demobbed from there. Yes, I can remember that. With my suitcases, going to the station to get a train at the local station.
So what was the feeling where you were when once everyone knew that the war in Europe had finished?
Oh, I think really with that place, because it was non-operational, it was a case of, well, business as usual, because they were carrying on persuading these pilots that it was a good thing to go into BOAC.
Because one of the things, obviously, that was still occurring was the war in Japan, as we mentioned. So were there any notifications to the group or to OTU asking for pilots to go out to the Pacific theatres like and Burma and those sort of areas to help fight?
No. I don't think the Air Force worked that way. I don't think they sort of asked people what they wanted to do. They just sent you. You didn't get any choice, really, in the matter.
So once you finished your tour, I know some pilots obviously did a second tour, but because you went to OTU, were you then seen as you didn't need to do another tour because you were helping in different areas?
No, but it was timing, really, because by the time I'd finished my tour, August 44, they'd got so many crews coming through, I don't think they were wanting too many to go back on second tours. In fact, I heard sort of later that year about chaps who were training as pilots who were told, the course is finished, we don't need you. You know, a bit disappointing for them, really.
Okay. I know that when we were talking about the OTU that you went to, it was 28 OTU. Did you train any pilots while you were there? Or was it just a case of you just, I say just, but you were just doing the transportation? So did you do any training of other crews while you were there, or pilots?
Oh, yes. You'd be with them as the instructor on board for their initial flights while they were getting accustomed to the aircraft and getting used to the landings and takeoffs.
Did you have any challenging recruits? And did you have any challenging or interesting recruits in your
No, training? I can't think of any. No, I didn't have any difficulty in that way, really. I think by the time you got to that point, it was a case of being on board in case there were any difficulties on the initial flights, really.
Okay. Last two or three questions, really. Do you remember where you were when you heard the war was over, all of it, when Japan surrendered? Do you remember where you were?
I'm thinking. No, not especially, no. I think it was a feeling of relief all round, really. It's only the ones who got down to London and big cities that sort of indulged in any jollification.
Well, next part, which is pretty close to what I was going to say. What did you do after the war? So the war, you know, it's finished, it's over. Yeah. What actually happens to you now then?
Well, I was married by then.
Oh, where did you get married?
October 44, you see.
Where?
Where?
Yeah.
In Stratford.
So, yeah, you got married in October 44. And then what happens then?
Well, I carried on with this transport command and with the training of the BOAC people. And when I was demobbed, it was a case of getting a job. And that wasn't really exciting. Because my first pay was less than my marriage allowance.
What were you doing?
I joined, you've heard of Tube Investments? Well, I joined the export company, shipping all their tubes around the world.
Did, I mean, aviation... You didn't want to stay with aviation, or was that? Why didn't you stay with aviation?
No, I'd got a problem with my ears. That would have probably affected, if there'd been time, my going back on second tour might have stopped that, which I still have. I lost interest in flying as... From personal, all I've done really has been a passenger, which I find boring.
Do you keep in touch, or do you know if any of your crew is still alive?
The last one died about a year ago. The rear gunner. He was. I kept in touch with the wireless operator, the bomb aimer, and the rear gunner. He lived in Lincolnshire, retired there, a Londoner. Yes, he got dementia, I'm afraid.
Okay. And now, this is just like a cover-all question there. I know I've asked a lot of questions, but of all of the stories, the anecdotes, the memories that you have, is there maybe a couple that you normally tell friends? Are there any that stick in your mind from your time when you flew, stories or anecdotes?
Well, I think the two that stand out really are the taking off past the aircraft that was burning at the side of the runway. I mean, they say the worst things about flying is the takeoff and landing. The bit in between is just boring. And really, that couldn't have got a lot worse, really. The ground control chap did a marvellous job there getting us off, because, I mean, the damage from this one aircraft was bad enough. If there'd been other aircraft on the ground, they could have gone off as well. So we were lucky to get off. Now, that was the... I suppose, out of everything, that was the most thing that stuck in my mind.
And one more thing I meant to ask was, when you were on the base, obviously... When you're taking time off and you're going to the pubs and you're going to the cinema, as well as relaxing, do you remember any practical jokes, or I say hijinks, but were there any things that you remember which just alleviated the tension? Things that people, nothing serious, but just things that people did to, you know, just have a laugh.
Now, the one thing that I do remember, we were on this conversion unit at flying Halifax. We had a night off and we were in the pub, and someone came in and said two Halifaxes just collided over the bombing range. And we thought, oh, that's 14 crew gone, just like that. Oh well, turn around, I'll have another drink. Amazing, isn't it?
Yeah, well, it is.
And I was having treatment for my ears at the time, and I went to the sick bay the morning afterwards, and as I was approaching it, there was a chap coming out of the mortuary, I think, with an armful of burnt clothing. Couldn't got any worse, could it?
Did you have any missions that were cancelled, and you know, or missions that were aborted? Did you have any of those?
No, we were lucky, really. Every operation that we set out to do, we carried through, and the only difference being that occasionally we had to land away because the airfield was unserviceable weather because of weather. But the only operation that was cancelled was the one I was telling you about, when we were the spare crew. I think, as much as anything, that was to do with the time of year. If it had been, say, January, February, December, there was more chance of it being cancelled because of weather with the winter.
Yeah, I was going to say, because the icing on the aircraft, could imagine that being a
yes,
challenge.
Yes, yes. Yes, well, you've got to think, you know, minus 20 sort of thing, around 20,000 feet.
Yeah, I mean, was it cold up there? Was it cold for the crew?
Oh, yes. Well, the gunners had electrically heated suits, you see, when they worked. Mostly they did. But the heating arrangements weren't perfect by any means. Very often it was a bit spasmodic. But if we were flying at normal sort of bombing height, say 20,000 feet, we had oxygen masks on, of course. In fact, night operations that height, we would be on oxygen from takeoff, and up at that height, as you breathe out, it's wet. I got icicles on my eyebrows.
So you were you chipping them off?
Well, they dropped. I was busy with gloves on as well. I mean, you can't do a lot in that way. Mm. Oh, another interesting thing that happened in June, some character in the government or air ministry decided it would be a good idea if Bomber Command main force flew over London just to show that, you know, we're there and we're doing something. So there we were, and we weren't at a sort of, we'd be something like about 8 or 10,000 feet, you see, and there we were. And suddenly we start getting light flak coming up, you see. It wasn't bothering us because it was below us. We thought, oh, what the hell, you know, don't they know who we are? And then there were lights flashing around. It was only when we got back, it was the first night of the V1. What a coincidence. We were on our way to Le Havre to give that a pounding, you see, because they were holding out there, yeah.
No one told then, yeah. I mean, I can imagine there's some mistaking a Lancaster for a V1.
Yeah.
Obvious, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's got to be a V1.
It's a squadron.
Yeah, a squadron of V1s, can you imagine? Wow.